Hello everyone, my name is Adam. I'll be co-hosting our panel discussion today, which is all about rekindling the community spirit. And I'd first like to give a big warm welcome to all our speakers, our audience, and everyone watching at home on YouTube Live. So what we are here today to do is to reinvigorate community spirit during such a testing time, during such uncertain times. And from everyone here at Eire Dialogue, we are very grateful that you could join us here today. And we would really appreciate if you could subscribe to our YouTube channel, and any likes and shares would be greatly appreciated. So I'm just going to pass over to Sophia, who's going to tell you a little bit more about Eire Dialogue.
Great, Adam, thank you very much for this. It was a great introduction. Now, I would like personally to start off with a short introduction to Eire Dialogue. As you probably know, Eire Dialogue was established in 2010, and we are a sister charity of Dialogue Society. We have a number of different aims, but the main aim of Eire Dialogue is to advance social cohesion by connecting communities, empowering people to engage, and also contributing to the development of ideas on dialogue and community building. Eire Dialogue aims to facilitate dialogue on a whole range of different social issues, regardless of any particular faith or religion. We stand for democracy, human rights, equality, and freedom of speech.
Perfect. So I'm just going to talk a little bit about our Iftar Me initiative. So Iftar Me is a community-led initiative that aims to promote social cohesion among the diverse communities of people existing in Ireland today. So the purpose of Iftar Me is to provide a platform where people can share their breaking of fast virtually in a time when sharing this special time is virtually impossible for any of us. So we to give a little bit more detail about this, we will provide the dates where you may share your breaking of fast virtually with an accompanying family. And now we're going to show a little bit of a video to give a bit more information on that.
Do you like to experience an iftar with your Muslim neighbors? Iftar Me is a community-led project aiming to promote social cohesion amongst our diverse communities in Ireland. Iftar Me welcomes everyone. Inspired by the word iftar, a fast-breaking meal, Iftar Me involves families preparing delicious meals for their guests at iftar, with whom they will then share the fast-breaking experience. Only, how would that be possible with the current lockdowns and restrictions when people are forced to stay apart? Iftar Me has a solution for that too. The lockdown has seen a surge in people using alternative online platforms to get together. We will be benefiting from this opportunity to get together for the virtual Iftar Me gatherings. The event will run virtually by the breaking of the fast, with dates delivered by us, followed by enjoying a meal with a virtually accompanying family. The breaking of fast, a unique moment of togetherness despite the differences, distances, or distancing, will be shared. Initiated by Eire Dialogue, a non-profit organization who has several years' experience in organizing interfaith iftars throughout Ireland. Iftar Me is a project anticipated to take this one step further, bringing dialogue into our own homes, promoting a positive influence in our local communities. Iftar Me is inviting everyone to come together, enjoy good conversation, and end their day with a delicious meal. Through this, we hope to strengthen ties and build resilience between different communities in Ireland. So, how can I participate, I hear you ask? The invitation is at no cost whatsoever and open to everyone. Iftar Me is a space for inclusivity, and we invite people from all walks of life. If you would like to join, please fill in the form on the website and we'll put you in touch with a host family that will warmly welcome you. Virtual Iftar Me will allow households to share their iftar experiences with one another despite the pandemic.
So yes, just to reiterate that, if anyone watching at home wants to get involved with Iftar Me, then just head over to our website, airdialogue.ie, and you can use the online form to sign up there. So now I think we're going to move on to the Kahoot game, which is going to be hosted by Sophia. So Sophia, if I want to hand over to you now.
That's perfect. Okay, so that's great. So what I'm going to do now, I'm just going to... Sorry, just a second there. So the game will be consistent of 10 different questions, and 5 of those questions will be on the Ramadan itself, and 5 other questions will be more generic questions on Ireland, okay? So you will have about 20 seconds to answer each question. And then after that, the 3 winners and the 3 people who score most points, they will be able to get prizes and vouchers from us, okay? So just 1 second there. Just trying to share my screen with you. Okay, so hopefully you will be able to see that there. Perfect, just give me 1 second. Okay, just let me know if you can see it now. Are you able to see my screen now?
It's your speech.
Okay, well, that's not what it's supposed to be. Okay, apologies there for a bit of delay. Unfortunately, I don't. Okay, perfect. Yep, you should see it now.
Yep.
Perfect. Okay, that's great. Apologies there for a bit of delay. Okay, so now what I'm going to ask you to do, if you just go to the Kahoot website, you will see on my screen, you will see the game pin that you can enter to play that game. So if you just enter in your Google search Kahoot game and enter the game pin that you see on my screen, you will be able to join the game and play with us, okay? It's a multiple choice question, so you will have 4 different answers and only one of them is correct. For every point, for every answer, you will get 1 point if you're successful, okay? So we're just gonna wait a couple of more seconds in order for everyone to join the game. Anyone else is joining? The speakers?
I'm not sure if I'm in or not.
I think you should, absolutely. We've got prizes.
Do I press the start or?
You just, so if you just, did you enter the game pin in your?
I'm not sure what that looks like. Is that the EN at the top?
It's Kahoot game and it's just, I think it's play. It should stay play.
Okay, I have game pin and Kahoot at work start, would it be?
Yeah, that's perfect. Yep.
Okay. Not sure if I'm in or not.
Okay, so do you see your name on the screen?
Nope, but I see Daithí, so
Caroline is here.
I'm not Belmont, am I?
Oh, Dermot, you'd have to pick the name. If you go to kahoot.ie.
I'm on a screen up here which says it looks like I'm in it. I can see all the names.
Okay. Oh, perfect. Okay. Well then.
But I don't know. I'm in there.
You'd have to pick a name yourself. You choose a name yourself, and then on your screen comes in, you're in. See your nickname on the screen.
Choose whatever nickname. So it doesn't have to be your name. You can choose whatever name.
No.
I don't think I'm in there, but don't slow for me, okay?
Perfect.
Is it Kahoot.ie or Kahoot. Something else?
Kahoot.it.
Kahoot.ie. Yep.
That's a nice way to wriggle out of it, Dermot. Don't wait for me.
No, I genuinely am trying to. Like, I can see Kahoot and a big game pin numbers in front of me, yes. And Kahoot at work and all the names, but.
Well, that's on the Zoom screen. So if you go to your browser and go to Kahoot.it. It'll ask you to put that pin number in and then it'll ask you to give your name and then you'll appear on the list of names there on the Zoom screen with us.
I'm really stupid, but I don't know how to do that way from the screen.
Dermot, have you got your phone with you?
Yeah.
If you go to Google, search on your phone and you put in kahoot.ie, it brings you straight in there.
Okay, just give me 1 second.
That's what I've done.
I'll wait for
I'm on my phone.
No rush.
You're losing points, though. You're losing points for every minute that you're not in the game.
Sorry, yeah. Probably right.
But I'm gaining points because it's Ramadan and I'm helping the less fortunate.
You're dead right. I am the less fortunate.
But where are you now, Dermot? What are you looking at now?
I'm typing in Kahoot.ie.
.it, not .ie.
Kahoot.ie, oh, .it.
IT. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So it's IT. Mm-hmm.
We're going to Italy.
Right, game pin is
693-6166.
Enter. Nickname, Asher Dermot.
Yeah.
Having and then you click on enter. Okay, let's go.
There you are.
Okay, there I am. Sorry about this.
Well, unfortunately, the game is over now, Dermot. We can all go home.
Okay, perfect. So I think everyone is in, so we're just going to play the game now.
Let's go. Okay,
perfect.
Yeah.
So good luck to everyone.
Not sure if I'm in there. I went in somewhere, but I didn't see the names. Anyway, it doesn't matter.
So according to the Islamic calendar, on which lunar months would Ramadan fall under? It's the 8th lunar month, the 9th, the 10th, or the 11th? If you don't know, I think you can just guess, and maybe you're lucky enough.
You click on the answer, yeah?
Yes.
Yeah.
So 6 people answered the question correctly, so congratulations on that. You received 1 point for that.
So when was it? The 9th?
It's the 9th, yes.
Oh.
Perfect. Okay, so the next question. You have 20 seconds to answer the question. Perfect. Where was Prophet Muhammad born? Medina, Riyadh, Mecca, or Jeddah?
I'm trying to answer.
Very good. Okay, so 13 people were correct in this one. So that's great. Perfect. So next question. What is Ramadan also called as? It's the month of Quran, months of reflection, months of fasting, or months of togetherness? Okay. 6 people were correct. Okay.
Oh, I actually put in, I clicked on the wrong one, but anyway.
You didn't mean this. Okay.
I meant
to. Okay. Congratulations. Perfect. So the next question, in which order will fasting come within the 5 pillars of Islam? The first, the second, the third, or the fourth? Okay, well, 4 people were correct. That's very good. Okay, and then, perfect there. And then we have the last question on the Ramadan, and we will then go with the questions on Ireland, okay? So what does it mean? Does it mean night of power, night of silence, night of peace, or night of solitude? Okay, that's not too bad. 6 people were correct. Okay, so now we have an easier part for many of you. Perfect. Well, so that's nice and simple questions there on Ireland. So I'm sure a lot of us will be able to answer that one. Great. Okay, so 11 answers were correct. That's great. Perfect. Now, next question. Who wrote the Book of Kells? Is it the people of Ireland, the monks, James Joyce, or is it unknown? Perfect. Great. That's lovely. Okay, so the next question would be, which county is known as the Garden County? Is it Wicklow, Waterford, Dublin, or Kerry?
Mine is frozen, and I know the answer.
Okay, it should probably work for you then. Did it work for you, no?
No.
No?
This is just... Okay. This is pure wrong.
Oh.
Well, it's coming up now.
Okay, so seven people said that it was Wicklow, and that was the correct answer.
I would have said Wicklow. I know I would have said Wicklow.
We're very sorry. Well, we can count that point, except that Kahoot doesn't count it. But we know that you know.
I would have got them all right if I had ticked the right boxes.
Yeah.
Exactly.
Isn't so, Dermot, you wouldn't be playing at all only for me.
So by what other name is the Liffey Bridge in Dublin known as?
I don't even know if I'm clicking them at all.
You'll know if it's clicking. It'll start doing a twirl in front of you.
Very good. I'm surprised 16 people knew the correct answer. That's great.
I'm not too sure if I got any twirls.
Okay, so Happening Bridge was the right answer. Great. Okay. So see, Adam was not able to answer that question yesterday. So see, 16 people knew that.
Yeah, if anyone's got low scores, you didn't do as bad as me. So
you're not supposed to retrospectively shame people for their bad answers. Not there yet.
Okay. Perfect.
Well, it says here, I'm in 14th place. So there must be about 15 people and Dermot is behind me.
I'm in 34th place because I think I
love the hell.
I think I'm doing people. Perfect. Okay. And so I think we have the last question there, true or false. So you've got a 50-50 chance. So if a leprechaun arrives at your door, you're legally obliged to give him a share of your dinner. Would that be true or false?
I'd give him all my dinner, to be honest.
I tell you,
very good.
If I've seen leprechauns at the door, it wouldn't be dinners I'd be giving them. It would be AA I'd be giving.
Well, I'd be asking them to give me a twirl because I'm not getting the twirl anywhere else.
Okay, it was actually false. I think the pitfall here was that you're legally obliged, by law, you're obliged to give them a share of your dinner, which is obviously not true, right? But okay, so that's lovely. Let's see. The results. Yeah. Okay, so Caroline is on the third place. The second place.
Well done.
And the first place would be. Okay, Belmont. Great. Okay, so the three winners can send us an email on info@airedialogue.ie and we will get in touch with you back to organize vouchers to be delivered to you. Okay, so we have prizes for the first, the second, and the third place. Great. Okay. So
I feel like I should be entitled to a voucher. So if
No, I'm sure you are. Perfect. No, great.
But I'm sure Caroline, in the spirit of Ramadan, will share her voucher with myself and Dermot. No
problem. Absolutely, I will. Yes, of course.
It depends what it is.
You anyway, Guy. Dermot wasn't even playing the game, so.
Yeah, Dermot. You weren't playing at all.
I was trying to play the game, just very unsuccessfully.
All right. 10 out of 10 for trying, Dermot. Good man.
Okay, so now that everyone's not done as bad as me in the Kahoot game, I'm going to give a quick introduction to the actual panel before we hand over to our speakers. So basically, during the COVID-19 pandemic, cases of loneliness and isolation have reached worrying heights, and that is exactly why we want to hold this panel discussion today. We want to revive the love, trust, and support across communities and to reconnect through a shared sense of togetherness. Through this panel, we wish to discuss the issue of loneliness and promote a greater sense of solidarity. We hope that this panel stands as a reminder that we are all a part of something that is bigger than ourselves. So on that note, I'd love to hand over to Dermot Lacey, who is the Labour Party councillor for Pembroke and South Ward. So over to you, Dermot.
Thanks, Adam. Look, it's great to be here, and I'm really grateful for the invitation. It's my first time participating in an event around Ramadan, so it's actually nice to be part of it. The Ireland I grew up in is a completely different country than the country we now live in. It was virtually entirely white. It was virtually entirely Catholic. It was totally conservative. Diversity wasn't welcomed in any form of life. So I love the changes that have taken place in Ireland in recent years, whether it be a multi-religious, whether it be a liberalisation of our laws relating to human behaviour and activity and sexuality, whether it's just an openness to all sorts of new ideas. I think that is one of the great things that we've done. And we've had this sort of social revolution without violence, which is a marvellous thing to say in the Republic at any rate. So I welcome this sort of thing. I welcome the opportunity to learn. I regret that I'm both lousy at quizzes, but even more so that I am lousy at using my computers, because I'm not even too sure if I answered any of the previous questions wrong. I suppose one of the upsides of the COVID is that a lot of people got to discover their own neighbours again, and they got to discover their own neighbourhoods again, and they got to discover the joys that are within our own communities. And I think that's a really important thing that we need to build on, because as a politician, I do come across some extraordinary loneliness in society. Loneliness in our city is enormous, maybe even more so than in less populated areas, because everybody thinks that everybody is looking after somebody else. I visited family today in a house that was Dickensian. No electricity, no running water, an outdoor toilet, and two elderly men. Well, in fact, I discovered they weren't so elderly, but two elderly men living on their own with no supports. Until a very friendly doctor living near them spotted them. And we now have a whole community group of about six or seven of us from different strands who are working with these two elderly brothers. And I reckon in about 3 months' time, these men's lives will be transformed beyond anything that they thought possible. And I think that only happened because the neighbor was at home and a neighbor spotted them. So the lesson, if we have a lesson from COVID, is to reach out. It's to encourage people to get involved. Outside politics, my biggest involvement is in the Scout movement, the biggest youth movement in the world, the most diverse youth movement in the world, the oldest youth movement in the world in many respects. And I would encourage more people to join that movement, because virtually every value, every feeling, every policy position I have stems from my involvement in that movement. It's integrated in a way that a lot of other organizations are not, in terms of social class, male, female, now mixed religions, and so forth. So the best way to avoid loneliness is get involved, get stuck in, and for all of us to reach out to other people. I think really, you know, we live in a great country, a country with many problems, but it is a great country, and we have great communities. And above all, encourage people to get involved, get stuck in, and I look forward to taking part in the rest of this discussion now.
Thank you very much, Dermot, for such a lovely message and for giving us a really nice sort of retrospection on where we've came from and how we've came to be as a country now. So on that note, I'm going to pass it over to Daithí Doolan, Sinn Féin councillor for Ballyfermot and Drimnagh. So over to you, Daithí.
Thanks very much. Delighted to be here. Delighted to be part of this great experiment. And I share many, a lot in common with Dermot. We might be on different political parties. He's Labour, I'm Sinn Féin, but we share a lot, I think, a very common vision, progressive kind of position on issues. And he reminded me, my first engagement with Ramadan was when I was 19. Many years ago, like many people in my generation, I had to emigrate to get work. I went to London and then London to Munich. and I was working in the laundrette in Munich. I come from Cork. I'm not from Dublin. So I come from the real capital, and I thought I knew it all. I thought I was from Cork. I knew it all. And I was in Munich, and I was working with two lads from Senegal. I spoke a bit of French. I still do. They speak a bit of French. They were practicing Muslims, and they were my sanity, and I was their sanity. We had some sort of common language, which is very important. And it was the first time I heard about Ramadan, when they were having to work, and they were hot, and they were thirsty, and they were hungry. And then we worked in a hotel, we did digs in the hotel, and one day Mamadou knocked on the door. I opened the door, and there he is, dressed in his finest attire. I'd never seen him dressed like this. And he brought food into me that night. I said, this is about Ramadan. And it was a whole new experience for me. This young boy from Cork having to engage and share and break bread with this man who sounded different, looked different than anything I'd seen in Cork. I come from Cork, when I left Cork in 1987, it was very white. You know, I was brought up in a very anti-racist household. It was a very white city. And now I have four young kids. And each of them know, appreciate, and celebrate Ramadan in their school. They go to school in the north inner city. And before I came up here, I'm in my room here on Zoom, my daughter Shefa said, "So if there's any questions about the Islamic faith, I'll answer them for you." So I know all about Islam. And she wasn't joking. And then having done that quiz, I wish she had been here, because I think it would have topped the poll if she had been here earlier on with the quiz. But they know all about Ramadan. Their friend, they come from a school that's predominantly, as a majority of the kids would not be Irish, or their parents wouldn't be Irish. Probably 80% of the kids would not be Irish. And I think that is such a different Ireland than what I was born into, grew up in. It's a far better, more inclusive, softer Ireland. And yes, there is the ugly face of racism. We know that's there, I'm not naive, but it's still a better country than the country I grew up in. It's a richer country, more diverse country. And I think that's something to be celebrated, defended, and built on, and events like this help do that. I was very excited to do this here today. I think it's great to actually, Ron just being a spectator, to participate in Ramadan, to participate in the iftar this evening. I think it's a wonderful experience, and to see it becoming part of our culture. And I use that in the broader sense. It's now part of the Irish culture. It's not something celebrated in the darkness somewhere else. It's celebrated in our country, in our cities, online and accessible. And I think, as we look forward, I think that there's huge challenges when we come out of lockdown. There's potential and challenges. And I think we need to tread carefully when we come out of COVID. I almost see it like it's not going to be one big bang, we'll all be out celebrating. I think some people will be hurt. I think some people will have their heads down. Their mental health will be deeply affected. As well as, I'm a city councillor, but I work outside politics. I work in a community-based drug project. I work in addiction services, and we have seen it transform the whole issue around addiction, homelessness, and mental health. And it has a very negative impact on those people who are surviving at the margins of our society. And I think if nothing, no other message is, well, let's put the hand out, let's stretch out the hand of welcoming, of support. We all have a story from COVID, but let our collective story be one of support, of companionship, of comradeship. And when we do come out of COVID, let's make sure our neighbours come out with us. Let's make sure, as Dermot quite eloquently, I was very touched by Dermot's story about the men in that house. Let's make sure that is our story, that that's the epitaph for COVID, togetherness. And I think my final point would be this. I think I have seen a really, really good community response to COVID. I don't think people have withdrawn into themselves. I have seen it here in Cherry Orchard and Ballyfermot-Drimnagh communities coming together, visiting the people Dermot pointed out, bringing food, bringing messages, prescription, the guards, the scouts, the GA, the politicians, the people who'd never done community work, people who read about community activism in the books. They were now part of it again. And I see it every week now with the tidy towns, people coming out and cleaning our streets and our parks and our pitches, picking up the rubbish. Even that in itself is part of it. So I look forward to coming out of COVID. I look forward to meeting some friends, embracing them, and sharing our common space, and sharing with new friends that I hope to meet tonight, and celebrating the new Ireland, and building on the gains and the goodness that we've made during COVID. And I look forward to participating in the rest of iftar and hearing other people's contribution. And Gura Mila Mila Margaret, thank you so much for giving me the opportunity and the privilege to participate this evening.
Thank you very much, Daithí, for making quite a few good points about a new Ireland, a more diversified Ireland. And that is definitely, from my own perspective, something that I've seen reflected in the north where I'm from as well. So on that note, I'm going to pass over to Sophia, who's going to introduce our next speakers.
Thank you very much, Adam, and thanks so much for the great speeches. Now, I would like personally to give microphone to Caroline Moore, who is Councillor for Kimmage-Rathmines Green Party. So thank you very much for agreeing to talk at our webinar, and the stage is yours now.
Thank you, Sophia. And I would just echo what Dermot and Daithí said, and just say, you know, thank you very much for the invitation. And I only wish there was food involved, and maybe you'll remember us next year if you're doing something in person. I think, like, for me, maybe it's something that kind of transcends all cultures, but particularly for Irish people, I think we're known for our love of actually sitting together and properly socializing and eating and drinking together. And for me, I think that's been one of the biggest things I miss. And I know we've all found ways to kind of try and replicate that sense of proper socializing, and this event is a good example of it. And you know, whether it's kind of doing Zoom quizzes with your family or whatever, we've all kind of leaned into the technology that's available, and I think that's been a very positive thing. And I think it's you know, it's been a real kind of lifesaver for a lot of people to have that outlet to actually meet virtually. But I think we all know deep down that it really isn't the same. And it's interesting what Daithí was saying there. You know, when we come out of the other side of COVID, I think possibly what none of us are able to appreciate yet is how profoundly we'll be changed by this whole experience, and how much our kind of our natural mannerisms and our natural way of dealing with each other has changed. I would hope that it's the experience of anyone who comes to Ireland, that they find us a very warm and welcoming people. And I think we're naturally a tactile people and a talkative people. And you know, I thought to myself last week, because it was my father-in-law's birthday, and we met up for a walk, and it was the first time seeing them in a while. And even though it was his birthday, there were no hugs, you know, there was just that kind of standing back and saying hello. And I kind of wonder to myself, like, how quickly will, you know, when we are in a position to actually properly embrace each other again as people, how quickly will we readjust to that? Or, you know, is there going to be a kind of a long-term impact that none of us can appreciate yet? But I think, you know, what both Daithí and Dermot have said about, obviously, as councillors, we have seen very much firsthand the impact of COVID in our communities, and the impact that that's had on people from the point of view of experiencing loneliness and isolation. I think in a lot of cases, though, what it maybe has done less so than create loneliness and isolation, it's possibly put a spotlight on how lonely and isolated a lot of marginalized and forgotten people in our society were anyway, even when we were all busy getting on with our lives and doing our commute and going to work and going to the office and going out for dinner and to the pub and whatever else. You know, there has always been a cohort in society that has been kind of largely forgotten. And I think one of the positive things to come out of COVID is that we have actually thought to now look around us and say, well, who actually needs my help? Who needs my support at this time? And I think that was particularly obvious in the first few months of COVID, when you really saw people just, you know, it was kind of a fight or flight response, that you really saw people trying to think, how can I really genuinely have an impact, and how can I help people in this crisis that is like nothing else any of us have experienced in our lives before. And I think you saw people kind of take to Twitter in a very innovative way, and start building networks of people who would just get in their car and deliver meals or get in their car and go grocery shopping for people. And all of that has been so important, I think, in reaching out to people in our communities. And that's been done in a very informal grassroots way, that it was almost people's instinctive reaction to this crisis that they had to kind of help in some way. But one of the I'm involved on Dublin City Council with the local community development committee, and one of the really astonishing things for me to be witness to over the last year was to see how quickly all of those organizations that are already out there working in our communities were able to just adjust and pivot and completely reorient their services to deal with the crisis at hand. And we had a couple of workshops about 2 weeks ago, again, virtual. You're just kind of hearing from people who are working on the ground in communities all over the country, and the speed with which they were able to just rally the troops and do what needed to be done in their communities was just astonishing. So I think in a lot of ways, you know, the crisis that we have faced has brought out the best in a lot of people. And I think, you know, I would hope going forward that that sense of community that we've forged together would actually take us, you know, beyond COVID and maybe into a new space where we start looking at other things that would really benefit from that community energy and that, you know, sense of everybody getting together behind the same objective. And, you know, I think we've unleashed a very powerful force in our communities, and I would hope to see that kind of used for the good going forward. So,
perfect, Carolyn, and thank you very much for this inspiring speech. And one of the things that you mentioned is that you really hope that the experience of everyone who comes to Ireland is that you're a warm and welcoming country. And that was certainly my experience. I did live and travel in quite a few countries around Europe, and I think one of these things in Ireland that really kind of pulls me back every single time, and this single reason why I return to Ireland every single time, is the people. Because I think the Irish people are like one of the best people I've ever met in my life. So absolutely, that's great. Okay, well, thank you so for that. So I now would like to give the microphone to Kathleen McGarvey, who is a member of the Bishop's Advisory Committee on Interreligious Dialogue. So Kathleen, the stage is yours.
Thank you very much, Sophia. And I'm really delighted to be here. Very, very grateful to Eire Dialogue for inviting me. As you said, I'm a member of the advisory committee or to the Irish Bishops Conference on Interreligious Dialogue. And it was actually Archbishop Eamon Martin who was invited. So unfortunately, he couldn't be here. So he asked me to be here to represent them. And I was delighted to do so. I'm a religious myself, a Catholic religious sister, a missionary of our Sister of Our Lady of Apostles. I worked for years in Nigeria, in Northern Nigeria, where I was involved in interfaith dialogue, worked especially with Muslims and Christians, particularly with women. Met great people there. We were working for peace, and of course there also conflict resolution, because it does tend to erupt too often, and unfortunately in the name of religion, even though we know it is not at all about religion. But I'm here in Cork. I'm involved with the Three Faith Forum, Muslims, Christians, and Jews. We meet regularly as well, kind of to raise awareness and to increase fraternity and friendship among us all, to work together somehow for a better Ireland, a more inclusive Ireland. So I'm delighted to be here. Usually, actually, I celebrate Iftar every year in Shanton Street Mosque. They invite us to Three Faith Forum. So this year we missed out on that. So it's great to be here with yourselves just virtually. As we know, fasting along with prayer and almsgiving and other, you know, sort of practices of doing good, Muslims and Christians, we're all called to practice it at all times. But Muslims are doing so in a particularly intensive way during this month of Ramadan, seeking to bring us closer to God who created us, and also with all those that we live and work with. So on behalf of Archbishop Martin and on my own behalf, I wish every one of us here and everyone who has joined online or who will watch it in the next few days, wish you all our Muslim brothers and sisters, a very blessed, peaceful and a fruitful Ramadan. I know that in Ireland the days are long, not like it was in Nigeria.
and it was it is in many other countries. We've got many hours here between sunrise and sunset. So I know that Ramadan on this side of the world can be particularly demanding. And then, of course, this year, when we don't have public worship and the opportunity to go to the mosque, I'd imagine must make Ramadan even more demanding for you all this year. So definitely assuring you of our prayer. And I think that the initiative that Eire Dialogue has taken to invite families to do their iftar together online is just beautiful. So well done. I think during these past months, as the others have said, we really all have become very aware that we belong to one another. We're all in the same storm. The actions of any one of us affects the lives of others. And we really are aware we are brothers and sisters. We need each other. And during these months, we've also witnessed great generosity and sacrifice of so many people who have been there for all of us. Frontline workers, as well as so many others, who have found ways and created ways to reach out in a spirit of community and solidarity. I know the Muslim sisters in Dublin, the Eire, Muslim Sisters of Eire, I think they're called, they're very active in giving out meals. I was with a group here in Cork as well on the street last year during Ramadan. I'm so impressed by the Muslims who were there having prepared these meals, offering them to people who were homeless or were hungry, and they themselves not eating. So it was a very strong witness from myself. And I think this is a time when we truly can appreciate that. So I hope that everyone here watching us has experienced somehow that friendship. And if you haven't experienced that friendship or solidarity during these past months, then tonight I just take this opportunity to extend the hand of friendship and assure you that I, as well as so many other Catholic faithful in the country, we're holding you very much close in prayer. In this past year in particular, Pope Francis has been encouraging all people, including world leaders, politicians, business people, to focus on themes of fraternity, social friendship, unity, and hope. Recently, he wrote a letter, some of you may have read it, Fratelli Tutti, it's called Fraternity and Social Friendship. It speaks a lot about our relationship with people of other faiths. And he emphasizes that fraternity is that principle that our world really needs today. Dialogue in all its forms, coming together as believers of various faiths and as people of no faith, is really important for us to build up that fraternity in our world, where still we see so much Islamophobia, we see racism, we see hate speech, we see conflict. So truly it is important that we work together and pray for it. We saw the Pope who recently visited Iraq, meeting the Shiite Grand Ayatollah Ali al-Sistani. That was a good example of reaching out. And last year or 2 years ago, he went to the United Arab Emirates, and himself and the Grand Imam there, Ahmad al-Tayeb, they wrote a great document together, a first joint document signed by a Muslim and a Christian leader on human fraternity for world peace and living together. And they invited all persons to who have faith in God and those who have no faith. But those of us who believe in human fraternity in our togetherness, to unite, to work together, to advance a culture of mutual respect, both for one another and for the earth. And Pope Francis, as he has said, it's by acknowledging the dignity of each human person that we can maybe find that universal fraternity that we all seek. He said, nobody can live, can face life in isolation. We need a community that supports and helps us, in which we can help one another to keep looking ahead. And he invites us all to dream of a better world, a world of justice, a world of peace for all people and all creation, where nobody is abandoned or marginalized. And as we work together to make that dream a reality. He said, let us dream as a single human family, fellow travelers sharing the same flesh, children of the same earth, which is our common home. Each of us bringing the richness of his or her beliefs and convictions. Each of us with his or her own voice. We're all brothers and sisters. Come together, let us dream. And I pray really that during this holy season of Ramadan, that we would all be helped to dream and to be strengthened so that together we can make that dream of a world of justice and of peace and of inclusion a reality. There's a group in Rome, like a department in the Vatican, the Pontifical Council for Interreligious Dialogue. And every year it sends a message to all Muslims for the month of Ramadan. And this year, the theme of that message is hope. And as it says, we all, especially Muslims and Christians, we who believe in God's mercy, pardon, and providence, we are witnesses of hope. And as it says in its message, during these long months of suffering, anguish, and sorrow, during the lockdown and the pandemic, we really have all sensed the need for God's assistance, but also for expressions and gestures of solidarity. A telephone call, a message of support and comfort, a prayer, help in buying medicines or food for the elderly, advice. To put it simply, we all just needed to know that someone is there for us in these times. And I really hope that each person has experienced that solidarity. And what we need most in these times is hope. Because as I say, optimism is a human attitude, but hope is something that has as its basis something beyond ourselves, which we of faith would call something religious. Because we believe that God loves us and that God cares for us through God's providence. And hope comes from our belief that all our problems and our trials, they have a meaning, a value and a purpose. However difficult or impossible it may be for us to understand the reason for them or to find maybe a way out of them. But hope also carries with it belief in the goodness in every human being. And many times, I think we have seen that during the pandemic, in situations of difficulty and despair, help and the hope that that brings us can come from those from whom we least expect it. And I think, as I said, in these times where unfortunately we still see Islamophobia and we still see racism, many of us may have been surprised from whom the help that came to us, from whom it came. So we just pray that all of that will help us all, you know, and strengthen our hope and our belief in each other. That spirit of fraternity, as we call it, which is, it transcends all boundaries, ethnic, religious, social, economic. May we all be bearers of hope for this life, the life to come, and may we all be witnesses and restorers and builders of hope, especially for those who are experiencing difficulty and despair. So I just pray that during Ramadan, that the hope that your faith as Muslims gives to each of you will be for you and for your loved ones, whether they are in Ireland or many, I'm sure, who may be abroad. May your hope be a source of strength and of inspiration. And may you each be able to share and to experience hope and love in fraternity with others here in Ireland and this country, as we said, so that life may be more beautiful and worthwhile for each person. And especially we think of those who suffer. So on that note, I just assure each of you of my prayer and the prayer of all of us. As I said, the message also from the Vatican, the greetings from Archbishop Martin. And I assure you of our prayer and I send best wishes to all our Muslim brothers and sisters for a peaceful and a fruitful Ramadan and a very joyful Eid al-Fitr, which we used to celebrate together with our Muslim friends as well at the end of Ramadan in Nigeria and indeed here too. Had opportunity to do so. So thanks for the invitation and for your attention.
Well, thank you so much, Kathleen, for this heartwarming speech. And it was great. And thank you for the kind wishes that you gave to everyone. And I very much hope that you continue working on promoting fraternity and making sure that you bridge communities in Ireland. That's absolutely great. And I would like to thank all the speakers for your great speeches. I think altogether, this is a great moment of sharing our thought and getting inspired by one another to keep up the community spirit, no matter COVID. I guess just kind of on that note, I would like to give the speakers the opportunity to just kind of like share your final thoughts or anything that you forgot to say. We'll just take that minute to do that, if that's okay. So if you have something to say, feel free to share.
If I could just jump in there for a second.
Thing. No.
Mm-hmm. Sorry, thanks, Dermot. Appreciate it. Very touched by the contributions of everybody, in particular by Kathleen down there in Cork, doing work, really struck a view of the Catholic Church that, to be honest, we don't often have the luxury to hear that message of togetherness and unity and peace and respect and anti-racism. And I think you also put down a challenge for us to challenge Islamophobia. And that's a huge challenge for all of us, believer, non-believer, Catholic, Protestant, Muslim, Jew, politician, community activist. And that is a challenge that I think if we call it Ramadan, call it COVID, that we come out committed to standing shoulder to shoulder with each other to challenging Islamophobia. It's a horrible, ugly, unacceptable face of racism. And my final point would be this, that racism isn't something that just jumps out at you. Racism is insidious. It's a look, it's a stare, it's a snigger, it's a joke, it's a comment, it's a cold stare, a hard stare, And I think it's up to all of us to be just to stand with each other and challenge the racism on the loose, in the workplace, in the council chamber, in the House of Eurotas, in the church, in the synagogue, in place of worship, on playground. And it's up to all of us to the who's saying it. Let's all make a commitment to support each other and challenge racism and make Ireland that great country Sophia has painted, a country where we can hold our heads up high and say, we're not going to be held down by the shackles of racism. We're committed to building a truly anti-racist, inclusive Ireland. And the very last point is that I think it's interesting. This is the second Ramadan of COVID, not just one, but two. I think that shows it must be very difficult on our Muslim neighbours and colleagues. And so our love and respect and support and solidarity to all our Muslim brothers and sisters who are missing each other, the friends, the warm embrace, the sharing of food. You're in.
This, that is absolutely great. So many different insights. Great, thank you very much for this. Anyone else has to share anything?
I couldn't say what Dai said better. Mm-hmm. I fully agree with him. I would just share one thing, and it's only in the last few minutes I've been thinking about it. I think our attitude as a society now to all religions is a reaction to the institutions of all of those religions. And as a society, we actually very seldom talk about the fundamental values of religions. We react to abuse or events that happen in some of the Eastern countries, so Middle Eastern countries, but we don't actually discuss anymore the values of those religions. And that's perhaps something that we should do. And the second thing is we need to have more events like this. I learn from these events and I value them. And I think the more that people understand differences, the better. And it understanding eradicates ignorance. And that's what we need to do. But thank you very much for the opportunity to be here and the opportunity to participate.
No, thank you very much for joining us. It was great to have you all. Now, I guess just kind of next, what we're going to do, a marbling show with our director Afra, who you met before the meeting. So Afra is a cloud strategist and she works for Microsoft, and she's also a CEO, a director of Eire Dialogue. So what Afra is going to do, she's going to do a marbling show. For those of you who are unfamiliar with the term marbling show, it's marbling is also known as ebru, which is the art of creating colorful patterns by sprinkling and brushing color pigments on the pan of oily water and then transforming them over on paper. So Turkey has been always one of the centers of marbling since the 13th century. And Afra is going to demonstrate that for you. Thank you. That is great, Afra. That is beautiful.
Hi, everyone. Thank you so much for having me. Hope you enjoy the art.
Fabulous.
Yeah. It was beautiful. Mesmerizing. I could probably watch that for hours and hours.
Does Afra have a YouTube channel? Because I could have watched that all night.
I will share it with you, Caroline. Don't worry.
It was so relaxing.
It is. It's quite... Like it's a, I call it always, it's a magical art. Like you, like it's super relaxing and it's like dancing colors on water. You just like, it's fascinating. I am still watching it every week. So yeah, thanks.
That's great. Thank you so much. Thank you. That's great. So what we're going to do now as well, we're going to have a short prayer for those who want to stay behind. It's a very short one, about 2 minutes. So I think Afra is going to do that as well. So we're just going to wait for that to start. Sorry, that's probably a technical difficulty there. Apologies there, I don't know. Just gonna get in touch with Afra quickly to find out if that's gonna go ahead, because I don't see anything on the screen for that. Okay, so it's coming now. Perfect. That's great.
Allahu Akbar. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله أشهد أن محمد رسول الله حي على الصلاة حي على الصلاة حي على الفلاح حي على الفلاح Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar. La ilaha illallah. اللهم رب هذه الدعوة التامة والصلاة القائمة آت سيدنا محمدًا الوسيلة والفضيلة والدرجة الرفيعة وابعثه مقامًا محمودًا الذي وعدته إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. رضينا بالله ربا وبالإسلام دينا وبمحمد صلى الله تعالى عليه وسلم رسولًا ونبيًا. Amen.
That is great. Hope you all enjoyed it. Okay, so we're going to end our panel here because, as you all know, all good things, they must come to an end. We would like to thank myself and Adam. We would like to thank everyone for joining and watching the panel today. We had some great speakers and thank you so much for your contribution. And as a closing remark, I just would like to remind you that we welcome if you could subscribe to our YouTube channel to keep up with the future events that we organize. And thank you very much as well. So if Adam wants to say some final remarks himself.
Yeah, just to reiterate at that point, we do really, really appreciate all the points that everyone brought up. And I personally as well was thought there were some really great points that each speaker made. So your contribution definitely hasn't gone unnoticed and it is really greatly appreciated. So again, just to reiterate that, thank you very much for coming and joining with us today.
Thank you very much, everyone.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. You are.